Yeah, hello everyone. Greetings from NSN Hyderabad. Today we have another guest with us who's going to share a lot of information, knowledge, and expertise from the EdTech field. As you may be aware, EdTech is something that's catching up in a very big way, especially post-COVID. But this company, which I am talking about today, has been pioneering excellent work in this field in terms of employability of youth in many industry sectors. So welcome to this talk, Dr. Shantanu Paul. We are very happy to have you here. Dr. Shantanu Paul is the CEO and Managing Director of Talent Sprint, which is based out of Hyderabad, but it has a huge presence across the country since they have very strategic tie-ups with academic institutions and the industry. And today we are here to learn more from Dr. Shantanu about how he has achieved all this and what is the impact of digital disruption and many other aspects of the current scenario of talent acquisition. So let's go ahead, Dr. Shantanu. First and foremost, I would like to learn from you, or rather our audience would like to learn from you about how do you manage such strategic and productive and fruitful partnerships with academia and the industry in terms of youth employability?
Thank you so much, Madhuri, for the warm introduction. It's always a pleasure to talk to you. It's always been, and I'm a great admirer of the work that you do at NSN, so please keep it up. And thank you for this opportunity in particular. So to your question about what we've been doing over the years to build our partnerships with industry and academia, especially the blue chip industry and top tier academia, and of course, we'll talk about examples of those, is that I think we came to a conclusion at some point that if you look at young professionals looking for their first career break who are currently in college, you know, while it's exciting for them to learn new technologies and all of that is definitely true, they really want to have industry validation. So young professionals want industry validation because sitting in academia in the final year of college, they feel like the big gap in their lives is industry connect. So if you bring them closer to large industry, great companies and content from great companies, certificates from great companies, they feel that this is a phenomenal thing to happen. And therefore we focused on building partnerships like Pegasystems, like Google, et cetera. Of course, those programs all have their unique features, but they are all very big partnerships. And therefore college students get very excited when they see that TalentSprint is working with Google, working with Pegasystems, working with other such large companies, and especially boot camps and those partnerships tend to be very popular. That's one part of the answer to your question. The other part of the answer is exactly the mirror image of that. If you look at working professionals who've been working in industry for 10 years or 15 years, they have a crisis which is different. Their crisis is not looking for a job. The crisis is looking for career upskilling and a career opportunity that takes them to a new place. And the common term they've used there is role change. You know, you're all stuck in a role that you want to change and you want to do something different. And if you look at industry professionals, they have by now become a little more jaded and soured on industry itself, ironically. What they want is a fresh academic rebranding, right? For example, if somebody's working in the IT service industry in a good company for many years, and they may feel stuck in whatever they're doing because that's how industries operate, they feel like if I go back and get an IIT certification or an IIM certification or an ISC certification, which I did not have in my regular academic resume, right? I did not have a chance to go to these so-called premium places in my college, but now is a chance for me to actually work with TalentSprint to get access to such brands in terms of executive education and deep tech certifications, then they actually love those programs. So finally, the irony in this is that, you know, people in college love industry and people in industry love colleges.
Yeah. So, and also you have your own platform for offering all these courses online and in a blended format. So how do you foresee now the future, let's say post-COVID, which has kind of accelerated the adoption of technology in education and training? On the one hand, this acceleration, and on the other, we also see a disruption in the world of work with the patterns of work undergoing changes, the gig kind of work coming back in a rather picking up in a big way. So how do you foresee these two things coming together? Is that going to impact talent acquisition in the coming years or months?
I think there are, you know, it's an interesting set of questions you asked there. I think, you know, clearly COVID is a game changer. Just like I like to say that demonetization in 2016 was a game changer for the fintech industry. COVID is the equivalent game changer for the tech industry, right? I mean, that's how, you know, it's all of a sudden industry's been kind of floating along for a long time in a reasonable growth phase, but then here comes a tailwind that completely changes all the assumptions. So even our technology platform for EdTech, which is called iPearl.ai, iPearl is one of our, you know, now the brand is called iPearl. And this platform we've been kind of building systematically for the last 7-8 years. And it was primary purpose historically, pre-COVID, was to provide a platform through which instructors could teach from across the country and students could learn from across the country, right? So teachers get into studios and teach and learners get on laptops and learn. That was the whole idea. And of course, there was a big premium in those days, pre-COVID I'm talking about, where classroom learning still had a high premium. Today, of course, post-COVID, classroom learning just evaporated. And luckily for us, our platform had reached so much maturity already pre-COVID. It was like a hidden weapon that we had that we did not know we had, right? And suddenly we said, okay, here's the weapon. Let's take it out and actually use it for digitalizing every classroom we have. And luckily for us, all our programs switched over without a single hitch. You know, it's a perfect rollover to a new world overnight. Mm-hmm. And we were pretty surprised that our system stood up so well when all classrooms that are physical went online almost literally overnight in last year, April. And then we got this new insight subsequently that in the post-COVID world, there are partners of ours, IITs, IIMs, through which we do executive education. They also run MBAs and BTECs, and they were all kind of, the campus were closed. Students were not allowed to come back. And these guys were running MBAs and BTEC programs that had to go on. So all of a sudden, we found IIMs and IITs coming to us and saying that, can we use your platform? We're using it for executive education with you, along with you. But now, can we use it purely as a service, platform as a service? That's the big term. Can we use it to run our BTECs and MBAs? And today, some IITs and IIMs have adopted our platform as the primary way of running a digital campus, right? So the physical campus is what it is. It's premium, it's famous. But the digital campus they're running is running on talentsprints.iPearl.ai. So short answer, I think, to your question is that, you know, sometimes you plan for something, and the plan never works out, but the preparation you put into the plan turns out into an asset. And so I always now say that you should over prepare and under plan, right? And then you never know which way the world will approach you. Your preparation will really take you to a new place. So to final part of your point about new age work, I think the future of the workforce is going to be a lot of digital workforce. Gig was already happening. And before this, gig will accelerate. And I think one interesting thing that I've read about recently, which I want to share here, is that, until COVID happened, all CEOs around the world were afraid to reduce workforce, because when you cut your workforce, you do optimization of your workforce, there is a, you know, social stigma that comes with it as a CEO and a company saying that, oh, you are cutting the workforce. And therefore, automation initiatives like robotic process automation, digital automation, AI, all of these automation projects, while they were happening, it was hard to put them on a very high gear, because the fear was that the so-called side effect of job loss would always come back to haunt companies. So everybody was very cautious. But with COVID, people sent off 70, 60, 50% of their workforce home permanently at that point in time. And a lot of companies cut their workforce to survive. Now when you have to add back, will you add back people or will you add back automation? And I think the debate now is that, you know, the future of hiring might be that, you know, more automation and less hiring than before. Because now there is no concern that people are building back from a smaller base. I mean, add new people or add new bots. I think the economics can dictate a more automated world, and they're already dictating a more automated world. CEOs no longer feel ashamed to say that, okay, we are automating very heavily. Mm. The nature has taken care of the workforce reduction for them.
I think this is a very nice way of weaving all the ideas and the thoughts together, the way you explained. I'm sure this is going to help most of us understand better the link between the emerging world of work and how the technology is rapidly changing it. Look at the other side of training, which is mostly at the level of, let's say, basic skilling and skill development for, let's say, entry-level job roles and similar things. For example, if you take cybersecurity and a few other technologies, which are, I believe, generating a lot of jobs at the entry level or at the basic level. And on the other side, we have, since NSN also brings a lot of visibility to government programs and various schemes from the government, I would like to bring this aspect here, how somebody can, get benefited from this particular thing. Let's say the government now is emphasizing on Industry 4.0 skills for even programs or schemes like PMKBY, which is a free or partially paid kind of a scheme. How do you foresee technologies like AI, ML, or robotics, or 3D printing, or cybersecurity being offered at such level? If we have to refer to, let's say, NSQF levels or any of those things,
Yeah, no, I think this is a great question. And again, you know, I think the, you know, there's a multiple ways I can try to answer this question. So bear with me if I'm going to ramble a bit on multiple topics here. I think fundamentally the issue is that, you know, the governments have to enter a workspace or enter the field when we believe that the buyer, the potential beneficiary, needs the skill but doesn't have the means to get it, right? So if that is true, then the government has a role to play. If, for example, if somebody wants to become a great programmer, right? I think there's so much aspiration value to being a programmer that you can make it a B2C business. You can make the learner or the trainee pay for it, right? And then therefore, you know, wherever there is actually a chance of the aspiration value being very high for a certain kind of skill, it's quite possible that you will have people finding ways to fund it, whether through their own money or borrowings, or today there are fintech companies who give digital lending. You can, you know, borrow funds in cases where you don't have the means directly, and you can start paying back when you get the job. So first of all, I think the government should not enter spaces where the aspiration value of the job is very high, because those are fundable through other means, retail, loans, etc. Right? Now, where does the government have to play a role? Government has to play a role where there is a low aspirational value, but there is a huge need for that service to actually proliferate. Right? Mm-hmm. So that's the first test. I mean, the skills that the government should be imparting through PMKBY kind of schemes should not in some sense have to compete with the retail skills or aspirational jobs. Then it's a kind of a, you know, it's sending mixed messages. Let the jobs that can fund themselves in terms of people funded training, let them happen in the retail model, in a consumer model, because we know today that, you know, B2C works in India. People buy things, right, all the time.
Yeah.
Having said that, I think there is another challenge here, which is that if you look at the nature of the workforce itself in the future, I think if you think of it as a pyramid, right? The top 1 or 2% people will be what I call creators of algorithms. These are people who create an algorithm, build an app, build a company, build some software, and that is a huge success. It changes the way people do things. Like, for example, if you are somebody who wrote the algorithm for Uber or Ola, then you are in that 1%. You are creating a new algorithm that changes the way the entire transportation industry works. And these are people who we call innovators, entrepreneurs, you know, game changers, whatever term that is favorite of ours, you can use that. But on the other hand, right below that 1-2%, there is 20-30% people who are going to be what I call collaborators of algorithms. These are people who know how to use a complex algorithm. Like, for example, if you are a radiologist who is looking at images, right? You know, we all have family members who have gone through complex medical problems, and you spend time in the hospital looking at images and x-rays and MRI scans. And, you know, radiologists today don't look at just a scan. They actually use AI, and the AI kind of pinpoints them to a problem area. So they use their judgment on top of that level of AI. That's one example. Other example is if you look at a commander of a Boeing 777 or a 747 today, which is highly automated, the commander of the flight is not flying the plane manually for more than 2-3% of the entire flight duration. The remaining 95-97% is being flown automatically. It's called fly-by-wire, algo-driven, right? So in other words, people who know how to use the algorithm that's complex and know how to collaborate with it, that's the second next class of competencies, right? Doctors, lawyers, the new professional class will be what I call algorithm collaborators. But still, the pyramid at the next level is like 60-70% of the population will just basically follow the instructions of an algorithm. You're an Uber driver, you are dropping food on behalf of Swiggy or whatever. The algorithm is telling you what to do, right? Now, this is the class which is a non-aspirational job sector, right? If you look at the top one or two, those are aspirational job sectors. Government has no business trying to solve problems in aspirational job sectors. Those people will find a way to fund. But when you talk about providing better people who can use technology and take instructions and do follow instructions, those are where PMKBY has a role to play. So maybe you don't get to write the algorithm in a PMKBY, but you know how to use the technology that can tell you what to do next. So my view is that, yes, there is a clear need for teaching AI, blockchain, cybersecurity is a good example, because cybersecurity is an area where most people will have to follow instructions from an algorithm. Right? Mm-hmm. So wherever you have to follow instructions from an algorithm, I think the government can play a big role in proliferating that skill set. Having said that, I must say that in the India's success story in creating big solutions through government-funded skill programs is not great, to be honest. The problem is much bigger than what any private sector can do, certainly even bigger than what the governments have been able to achieve. Yeah. So I think attempts have to be made, but government should not waste a single resource or a single rupee where there is an aspirational sector. That's my view.
Right. Well, thank you. Thank you for detailing it out and sharing your views. I think it is definitely making the more sense now to understand the layers at which such jobs are getting created and how it can attract different sets of people for those jobs. Now coming to another important aspect is the recent acquisition of Talent Sprint, and what is the kind of roadmap that you have going forward? So this was in the news and we are all curious to know what is in store for the various training programs and other initiatives.
Sure. No, that's a great question. I'm glad you asked it. So this happened about 3 months ago that the National Stock Exchange of India, through its NSE Academy subsidiary, which is education arm, took a majority stake in Talent Sprint. And over the next 3 years, they will basically buy out the entire company in stages. That is the basic structure of this deal. Now, why is it that someone like NSE is interested in this deal? That's the real question, right? I mean, of course, as an entrepreneur, we're always excited when we raise money, when we get, you know, an exit, all that is nice. But you have to ask the question that what's in it for NSE? Let's start with that question. So I think one of the interesting things NSE has actually realized over time, if you think about NSE's real business, right, core business, it's about running a stock market using technology. It's an automated platform for a stock exchange, which is India's largest stock exchange. Now, if you think of the challenge in India today, you know, the stock markets, while they're very technically sophisticated and while they're very large stock exchanges by global standards, in reality, a very small fraction of Indian population today is participating in the stock market in terms of wealth creation. You know, people, first of all, most people don't have money, so that there's no bank account. If they have a bank account, they put money, a little bit of money in a savings account. And only about maybe 2-4% of the population is actually putting money into, you know, mutual funds or stock markets, etc. So if you are running NSE as a leader, what is your thought process? You're saying that how do I expand the base of people who can invest in the stock market? You want to expand the number of people, because if more people invest in the stock market over time and buy mutual funds and stocks and shares and bonds and derivatives and options, then all of a sudden the stock business, exchange business can expand. Right? Now you ask the question that who will have the money in the future to invest in these stock exchanges in greater numbers? And the question answer is that if you are a professional today in the workforce, either entering the workforce or in the workforce, who's going to get a better paying job by taking a particular course, then people who want to get improve their income standards and quality of work standards will have the surplus income to put in the stock market. Okay. And the question then is, who is producing such people? Well, the answer is Talent Sprint, right? Talent Sprint is not the only one, but one of the key players in helping young people and working professionals increase their income status, right? Income standards and social standing along with it. So these are the future people who will come into the stock market, so to speak. So in that sense, NSE strategy is a seeding strategy. If you have an edtech company, which is out there touching people who will eventually have more income, then that's a very nice place to be. It becomes like an automatic pipeline through which people will flow into the future of the stock market. So that is a theory. It's a big theory, but it's an interesting theory. Having said that, NSE is, of course, a very successful company with lots of you know, surplus cash that they generate. So they want to enter education technology business, and they want to enter a analytics business. So they did a couple of acquisitions around the same time. You will see that there are two announcements around the same time, one for EdTech, which is us, one for analytics, which is a different company. So what they did was they said, look, if we can actually get behind these companies, the future of information management is analytics. The future of the kind of people who will become our natural customers is EdTech. And through their survey, they came to the conclusion that, hey, you know what, if you back a company like Talent Sprint, Talent Sprint has already locked up most partnerships with IITs, IIMs, and ISC. They also have great partnerships globally with Google and Pega. So that was the thesis behind this whole partnership. Another few, to give a very short point about what is ahead, clearly we want to dominate the Indian market in executive education for deep tech, not for generic technologies. I don't think we'll be doing all kinds of generic stuff. We'll do very specialized deep technology, AI, machine learning, blockchain, fintech, cybersec, et cetera, et cetera. And of course, we will do a lot of coding boot camps in partnership with global partners, like what we have with Google and Pega. So the future will be, I think you will see a domestic academic partnership model for working professionals and a global partnership expanding for boot camps in India for college students.
Okay. Yeah, that's very interesting. And I think, like you said, you're playing a very important role now in changing the course of action itself for the industry, and particularly in deep tech. Besides this, is there something which you can share with us? Let's say, for example, you know, in the area of skilling, upskilling, and reskilling, as we commonly say, what would be your advice to people, to young people, or to even other training companies, you know, and how they should go about maybe framing courses or trying to attract people and then make them aware? First of all, as we know, many people think that there's no need to continuously learn. The entire, you know, idea about lifelong learning or continuous learning, these are all things which are still not ingrained. So As my last question, I would be happy to learn from you about something in the area of skilling, reskilling, and upskilling for various levels.
Yeah, this is a great question, and I'm glad you asked it. You know, we think about this all the time, and I have some thoughts about it I'd like to share. So first of all, I think if you're a student or a working professional who wants to really upskill to the next generation of emerging technologies, which will give you a great career ahead, the most important thing to realize is that, you know, we obsess in India a lot about, you know, what to teach, right? If you talk to colleges, they will say, industry should come and tell us what to teach. Mm-hmm. If industry asks them, what should we do? We should tell colleges what to teach. And I always say that what to teach is the wrong problem. Our problem is not what to teach. Our curriculum in a second year engineering college in computer science is identical to the curriculum of MIT in computer science or Stanford in computer science. If you look at the table of contents and download the brochure, the curriculum is identical, if not 5-10% here and there. So clearly what to teach is not the problem. The curriculum is known to everybody. It is how we teach where the problem is. The way we teach historically is we want to finish the syllabus and we want to write an exam and get a grade. In the top universities in the world, that is not the objective. The objective is the same syllabus goes through a different treatment. There the idea is that what can you build with this? What are you creating with this? You know, so I always say that, you know, skilling is a verb and not a noun. What does it mean? In India, we talk about physics, chemistry, Java, Python, they're all nouns.
Yeah.
Even AI, machine learning, they're all nouns. But if you look at a Western education system, they talk about designing, researching, presenting, analyzing, discussing. They're all verbs. Yeah. Our problem is we should be teaching verbs, we're teaching nouns in every subject, in every area, in every college. And that is the reason why people come out, they can't form sentences because they don't know the verbs, right? The reality is that we have to get to the point. So my advice to a student, a learner, as well as to a training institute would be very simple. Please don't obsess so much about what you're teaching. Obsess about how you're teaching. What's your pedagogical advantage? What's your differentiation? Are you people learning by doing? Are they learning by, if you learn by listening versus learning by doing, it's very, very different. The outcomes are very different. So I would say that as a student, go to a place to learn which can teach you how to build something, how to create something with this, not where you can memorize the nouns and pass an exam. And same with training institutions. So I think that's a Talent Sprint unique secret sauce. We obsess heavily about, after taking this course, what can you do with it? Not what have you learned, but what can you do with it, right? That's a very important philosophy. And my last part here on that, a lifelong learning, is that I do believe that the future is not going to be this highly bundled four-year BTech kind of thing. It'll become unbundled. I think education will become unbundled because, you know, no one institution, in my view, in the future can provide the best content for all the courses in all the years for all the subjects. So the future will probably be that I come in, I do 2 years of college in a nice place. I go work for 2 years. Then those two years of work, 1 year I get credit for because this is like classic. I'm getting credit for work that I've done. And then I go back and do another 1 year in another college. At the end of it, I have a complete BTech degree, which includes work, includes learning from multiple institutions and some companies too. And when you assemble that meta framework of work, credits, and learning, that's a real learning experience. So I always say that, you know, you have to unbundle it, right? Our education is overly bundled, provided by one institution at a time. I'm signing up for 4 years of BTech or 2 years of MBA from a single institution. How do we know they have all the expertise required to make me a great professional? They don't. Yeah. It has to come from a mixing and matching of multiple content from multiple universities. That's when you want to get the best, plus industry experience. So that's my view of education. It has to get unbundled.
Yeah. Yeah. And also, I think this will open up many avenues for people to do, like you said, multiple things at one time. And your previous idea about, not idea, but I would say the observation about applying knowledge, or, you know, where you said the focus is more on what and not how, I think that needs to be resolved in a very big way, like the way you made it so easy for us to understand by using the noun and verb distinction. I think this is something that all of us will have to go back and think on, mainly to apply and to solve problems. I guess once we start doing it, things will change in a very big way. So Dr. Shantanu, thank you so much for talking to me today and giving us your valuable suggestions, observations, and all the learning that we got from you. I look forward to be in touch with you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Madhuri. I enjoyed this conversation as always, and I hope your audience finds this useful as well. So thank you very much, and congratulations once again for the great work that you're doing.
Thanks a lot. Thank you. Bye. Bye.